Hello, my dear friends. Myself, Bonaful Banerjee, once again back with you all in my channel, that is Hospitality Education PPT. And as you know that we are going to discuss another one part, very important part of Mid Basic, which is our part 2. Lesson 1 is already completed, that we have introduced about the meat introduction and the cuts of lamb and their usage of different cuts. Today also similarly you are going to discuss on another one vital animal, that is the beef. And here our area will be to clarify about what is called beef, how the animals are slaughtered, how the slaughtering process will affect the quality of the beef, that is the meat, and also how the animals are reared with different kind of feed, so that it will have some direct impact on the quality of the meat, that we are going to discuss. And obviously it will be eye opener for you all to know many things which is not very structured already in your mind. Okay, so without wasting further time, let us start with this topic, that is cuts of beef, and in details. Okay, so welcome to the channel once again. Very common question comes in our mind, that what is called beef. You may have some kind of idea already in your mind, however it is our duty to discuss it very thoroughly so that we can clarify it forever. What is beef? The answer is, beef is the culinary term. You understand, it is a culinary term. It is only used in the culinary world to refer to the meat. What meat we are going to refer by the name beef, which is derived from the cattle. Which cattle? Specifically from cows, steers or bulls. Clear? Culinary word is the beef. It is a kind of meat obtained from the cattle, especially cows, steers or bulls. What is a cow? Cow is the female version of the cattle. Steer, the animal which is castrated, that means the reproductive organ is removed, operational through operations, so that they cannot reproduce. So that is known as the steers. And bulls are the natural male version of that cattle. Okay, so that is cows, steers and bulls. It is coming under red meat category, and it has got a very distinctive flavor, tenderness and versatility. That is the quality criteria of beef. Beef is commonly used in various dishes such as steaks, stews, burgers and roasts, that will slowly come to know their usage in the culinary world. Now, we are discussing about the what mentioned rather, the quality of the beef. The quality of beef meat varies, or it depends on certain factors. Factors, what are those factors? It is the kind of breed of the animal you are going to use, at what age the animal is slaughtered, and the age of the animal as well. And the degree of fattening, that means the natural accumulation of fat in their body. All these factors having direct impact on the quality of the beef, and that we are going to discuss now. To get this kind of good quality factor, the animal is normally fed with different kind of food, and depending on that we get different kind of animals. So how they are reared in the farmhouse with a different kind of food, that is our point of concern. There are three ways. One is known as a lot fed. Lot fed animal is those where the minimum of 100 days the animal is fed on corn, grass and millet. Lot fed means it is based reared on corn, grass and millet for minimum 100 days, and allowed to move in a very limited area. That means they are not allowed to move so much in the place where they stay, in the farmhouse. Fat content in these animals are very high. Automatically, they develop lots of fat in their body, and they are the costliest too because of intense farming style. Clear? That is known as a lot fed. Second one is known as grass fed. Grass fed is a kind of farming where the animals are allowed to move in a slightly larger area and are fed with only grass for 70 days. Okay, that is a grass fed. And third one, very important one, that is known as a grain fed. What is a grain fed animal? The best quality beef is obtained from this kind of farming style, where the animals are allowed to move in a much larger area. They are allowed to move in a much larger area, and hence there is a lot of marbling. I'll clarify the word marbling, but not too much of fat. For the timing, you just know marbling indicating the amount of fat present in the body. So as a because of they are exposed to lots of exercises, so that is why they are not accumulating lots of fat in their body. But it is not too much. Am I clear? Not the flabby. They are having fat within the body, but not too much. The animal is fed with only grain and a little grass for 100 days. This quality is costlier than the grass fed. Now we'll clarify the word marbling. It is already highlighted. You can see on the screen. Marbling means, first of all, this is the image. You can see that it is known as the marbling. You can see the layer of fat in between the lean muscle. And we are going to clarify this like this. Marbling is the white flakes of intramuscular fat in a lean meat muscle. And it is very much available in case of red meat only. You can see this. The name is given marble because of this typical natural design they develop. That's why it is known as a marbling. And this marbling helps in making the meat more juicy, more tender, and with a good texture, and also it develops the flavor of the meat. Altogether, marbling or meat add on to a good eating experience of the meat. That is why it is required, and that is why we go for either lot fed, grass fed, and grain fed depending on the quality and style of farming. Clear? What is marbling? Fine. Now, classification of beef, because we do get beef from different animals. What are those? Let us clarify once again out here. Firstly, bull or cow. The male is called bull. There is no doubt about it. The female is called cow after calving. Though they have given the birth of a baby. Steer. The castrated male bull is known as a steer. Heifer. Cow which has not calved yet. Which has not given a birth of a baby. And the veal. The baby version. Young cattle. Age is between 0 to 6 months. That is known as a veal. It is very tender meat. And yearling bull or cow. Bull or cow under 12 months of age is known as yearling bull or cow. So that is the typical animal we get to see for beef. Bull, cow, steer, heifer, veal, yearling bull or cow. Okay. Concept is clear. There should not be any confusion in between afterwards. Now, as I have mentioned that according to science, slaughtering of the animal has got direct impact on the quality of the meat. It is proved that if the animal is exposed to lots of death pain, automatically the meat will become tasteless and tough, and it will become dry as well. So our basic purpose will be, whenever you are going to slaughter the animal by rule, they should not be exposed to lots of pain. Okay? So slaughtering has got a very good impact on the quality of the meat. What is that? Now in the world, we are having different kind of community people. There are three different kinds of slaughtering process available. One is known as jhatka in our local term, which normally followed by the Sikh or Hindu. I am not detailing what is jhatka right now. Just you know the term, jhatka is a method. Then another one is the halal, which is followed by Muslim. Strictly they go for the halal meat. And another one is the kosher or Jewish style of slaughtering, depending on their different kind of beliefs. These are the three different methods of slaughtering. But at the any time, whatever method you follow, jhatka, halal and kosher, the animal should not be given a pain at the time of that slaughtering process. So what is to be done then? The animal first of all should be fed well for 24 to 48 hours before slaughtered. Firstly, you are going to give them a rest, thorough rest for 24 to 48 hours. Once the animals are brought to the slaughterhouse, they should be given rest for minimum 24 hours. Why? To maintain the adequate strength of lactic acid, which is very much required for the tenderness of the meat. Okay, so the animal should be then, after well fed, they should be given a thorough rest for 24 hours. Purpose is to develop the strength of the lactic acid in their body. And then the time comes to stunning, apply the stunning process. What is the stunning process? Stunning process is a process which is used to make the animal senseless in a very fraction of a second. How it is done? Applying of 90 volts of electric shock to the eardrum for 10 seconds. The moment it will be applied, the animal will become senseless, and then you apply either jhatka, halal or Jeevi style of slaughtering. The animal won't be exposed to any kind of pain. And because of the stunning process, what will happen? It will help to bleed out the excess of blood from the total blood from the body. And more the blood comes out, the quality of the meat will become much better. Okay, so that is known as a stunning process. And then after, jhatka, halal or kosher style of killing the animal or slaughtering the animal. Fine. The animal should be bled immediately after stunning within 5 seconds. That I already have mentioned. Because of the application of electric volt, their blood pressure will be massive. And the moment they will be slaughtered, blood will start coming out within 5 seconds from the body, and that is very much required. They should be well bled immediately after stunning process. Okay. Now, one thing you must have also noticed in your life, that once the animal is dead, slowly it becomes very stiff and heavier in weight. That is basically in science known as rigor mortis. Here also the same thing happens. What is rigor mortis? Let us clarify that. Rigor mortis is also known as the post-mortem rigidity, which is a physiological process that occurs after death. A kind of rigidity, that means stiffening of the muscle, occurs after death, resulting in a stiffening of muscle tissue. This condition is one of the recognizable signs of death and is part of the decomposition process. So what will happen? Rigor mortis will start immediately. Onset of rigor mortis begins when, within 2 to 6 hours after death, the rigor mortis will start. And initially it will start from the face and the hands, and then slowly it will be covering the entire body. Okay. And it reaches to the peak after 12 hours. The rigidity becomes stiff maximum within 12 hours, and then after what happened? It becomes relaxed within next 24 to 48 hours. That is the feature of rigor mortis. So first it will start becoming stiff, and then after one point of time it starts becoming relaxed. Okay, So why we need to increase the lactic acid strength in the body? Because it will delay the rigor mortis process. Rigor mortis, we all know by this time, it is a stiffening of the muscle. If the muscle is become stiff, automatically the meat won't be tender and flavorful. We have to prevent the rigor mortis somehow. One of the processes is to give the animal rest so that it can develop the more lactic acid in their body. Clear? How to prevent the rigor mortis now? Already I have mentioned one. To prevent rigor mortis from affecting the tenderness of meat, several techniques are employed. Very first one is temperature control. Normally, the meat should be treated within 34 to 36 degrees Fahrenheit, that is between 1 to 2 degrees Celsius, so that the aging of the animal will start, that means the maturing. Higher the temperature will lead to the spoilage of the meat, lower temperature will affect the meat adversely. So try to maintain the temperature control first of all. Second thing, after rigor mortis, meat will become slowly stiff and it will become tender after 2-3 days of post-mortem. So you have to wait for 2-3 days, remember that. Further aging can improve tenderness and flavor, and of course after 2-3 days the meat will become more tender and more flavorful. But we cannot wait so long after slaughtering the animal. We have to follow another one process to prevent the rigor mortis, that is another tender stretch. You must have noticed this in different meat shops, that once the meat is slaughtered and well cleaned, the carcass is hanged. Why it is hanged? To prevent the contraction of muscle. That means to prevent the rigor mortis. By the time the meat will remain soft, you are not allowing the meat to contract. That means you are not allowing the meat to have rigor mortis action on it. How? By hanging it on the pelvis in your slaughterhouse. So automatically meat will become tender. How it affects the meat? Preventing rigor mortis can significantly affect the quality of meat, particularly its tenderness and flavor. How? Tenderness, if rigor mortis is prevented or minimized, the meat tends to be more tender. Normally, rigor mortis causes the muscle to contract and stiffen, which can make the meat tough. By preventing these contractions, the meat remains softer and more pliable. Okay? Juiciness, meat that has not undergone rigor mortis retains more moisture in their body, and obvious result is it is more juicier there. This is because the muscle fiber haven't contracted and pushed out the water contained. You get that clear idea in your mind. They're not allowed to contract. So naturally the moisture is not pushed out. Moisture is still intact in their body, and as a result meat will become juicy. Flavor. The flavor of meat develops during the aging process after rigor mortis. If rigor mortis is prevented, the meat may not develop the same depth of flavor. That is the only disadvantage, that if the rigor mortis is happening naturally, after 2-3 days of aging, automatically the meat will become tender and flavorful. But as you are preventing the rigor mortis happening out here, so there is a possibility that the meat flavor may not be developed to that extent, which is possible through natural aging process. You got my point? Good. Now I am going to give you the knowledge about the beef cuts. Beef cuts begin as large sections called primal cut, and primal cut, there are 8 primal cuts. We will show you in figure right now. So first of all, remember there are having big primal cuts, which is known as, there are 8 numbers of big primal cuts. These primal cuts of beef or primals, we call it, are then broken down further into subprimal or food service cuts. That means First, the animal is cut into 8 big pieces. Each piece is known as the primal cut. This primal cut again further cut into sub-primal cut or food service cut. Okay. The food service cuts are further sliced into individual steaks, roast, and other beef cuts we commonly see at the butcher or grocery store. And then those food service cut further cut down as per our preparations. So first is the primal cut or wholesale cut. From the primal cut we cut into food service cut. From the food service cut we cut into individual portions of different preparations. Clear? When a butcher has a side of beef, it is literally one side of the beef carcass split through the backbone. You try to remember one whole animal carcass which is longitudinally cut into two pieces. That is each half. Okay? Each side is then halved. Then each side is then halved by butcher between the 12 and 13th ribs. You have to count the ribs. By experience, we'll know. Between 12 to 13 ribs, it will be cut into half. That means from one carcass, we are getting two sides. Each side is then further cut into half, through which the 12 and 13 ribs. Now, we are getting two parts. One is the front part. Front part is known as the forequarter. And another one is the hind part, which is known as the hind quarter or back part of the cow. Clear? Now, let us see the carcass. Now, here we are talking about the wholesale cut. If you count, you will see that there are 8 cuts. Already we have mentioned that. And these are all wholesale cuts. From there, we will be getting the food service cut. And here you can see there is a line drawn. This is between 12 and 13 rib joints. And depending on that, the back part is known as the hind quarter. And the front part is known as the forequarter. Now you can see that different parts of the animal is marked with different numbers. And these numbers are the name of the cuts as we have mentioned as per the cooking process. And we'll discuss their name and accordingly try to identify the area. So let us start, and we consider that here the cuts of the beef, the carcass is weighing around 180 kgs. Depending on that, the weight is given in the sides. The first one, number one, is the shank. You can see from the hind quarter first. This is known as a shank. And in French, we call it la job. And also we call it lo jahe. This is known as the shank. It is used for clarification, beef tea, stews and mince. Because hardly you get the meat from this area. Then number two is this area you can see. Number two is known as the top side. Now top side in French we call it la trosse tendre, which is used for braising, stewing and second class roasting. Then number three, which is known as a silver side. This area is known as a silver side. You can see. Now silver side is known as in French la plate de cuisses. La plate de cuisses, mainly used for boiling brine and boiled, stewing and mincing. Then number four, thick flank. Thick flank. Number 4 is this. You can see this area. Number 4 is known as a thick flank. Le jit à la noix. Mainly used for braising and stewing. Number 5 is this area, which is known as rump. And rump in French is known as la culotte. La culotte is a French term for rump. Used for grilling, shallow frying and rump steak. Then number 6, in English we call it surloin. This one is known as surloin. In French we call it l'aloyot. L'aloyot. L'aloyot is in French. In English we call it surloin. Is used for first class roasting, grilling and frying. In the methods of cooking classes, all these methods will be explained to you in detail. Now number 7 is this. Still we are in the hindquarter part. Number 7 is known as the wing rib, and in French we call it le côte de l'oignon. Le côte de l'oignon means thick flank, used for boiling, stewing, mincing and sausage making. And the last one under a hindquarter is filet. This region is known as the filet, and in French also we call it filet. It is used for roasting, and it is known as the Wellington roasting, grilling and frying. Clear? This is about the hindquarter. Now let us switch over to the forequarter. Forequarter starting from number 10. Number 10 is known as a fore rib. In French we call it le côte premier, used for good roast, grilling, frying, etc. Then number 11, the next one, very next one, the middle rib, known as in French le côte découverte. Le côte découverte is used for second class roasting and braising. Number 12, the chunk rib. This one is known as a chunk rib. Chunk rib in French call it le côte du collier. Le côte du collier, the chunk rib, which is used for braising, stewing and mincing. Number 13 is sticking piece. This is known as a number 13, sticking piece, which is in French called le collier coud, used for stewing, mincing and sausage making. Number 14 is this one, is known as a brisket. Brisket is la poitrine. La poitrine is used for boiling, brine and boil, that is pressed beef, etc. Number 15 is this one. Number 15 is known as plate in English, and in French you call it le plat de côte. It is used for braising, stewing, mincing and sausage making. 16, this one, the top part of the front leg of mutton, l'épaule maquise, that is the leg of mutton. In English we call it leg of mutton, l'épaule maquise, used for braising whole and as steak, stewing and mincing. There are different methods adopted for that. And finally the 17 and 1 is almost the same. 17 is known as chine, l'os jaillet devant, that means l'os jaillet devant, used for clarification, beef tea, second class stew and mince. Now at one go I have mentioned the cards. It is not that difficult. Only your duty is to remember these along with the image and practice, so that you will be able to remember the names. In English it is very easy to remember, however you have to learn in French as well, so it will take little time, and depending on the practice you will come to know. So this lesson will be there with you. It will be your asset. Anytime, anywhere, you can go through it and learn it in a perfect manner. So with this we are coming to the conclusion of the day's lesson, and thank you very much for attending this session. Hopefully we have clarified various parts of the cuts of beef and also the animals, the slaughtering process, kind of rearing of animals. We have learned all those things. It has never discussed before, and first time we have learned this. Now we need to go through it once again afterwards, practice and learn and learn and learn. So it will be installed in your mind. If you have liked the session, definitely your valued comment is very, very important. If you have not liked the session also, then I honor your valued comment. Don't forget to put your comment in the comment box so that I can give you the answer. Any queries, any doubt, I can clarify it then and there. And if you have liked it, ensure that you are pressing the like button, bell button, and also subscribing it and sharing it with your friends so that this channel will become more popular and it will be helpful for all the friends, those who are doing hotel management in different colleges in our country and abroad. Very soon we'll be back with the part 3. There we are going to discuss about more detail about the big stake and all. Hopefully that will be another one interesting lesson for all of us. So till then, goodbye, take care, I'll meet you soon. Bye.